Happy Monday, everybody! You're listening to the Personal Playlist Podcast, fondly referred to as the P3. I'm Noah Daniel.
Music is a word within itself, with a language we all understand.
I am so excited to have Rachelle Dene Poth here on the Personal Playlist Podcast. Rachelle is an edtech consultant, presenter, attorney, author, and teacher. Rachelle teaches Spanish and STEAM, What's Next in Emerging Technology at Riverview Junior Senior High School in Oakmont, Pennsylvania. Rachelle has a Juris Doctor degree from Duquesne University School of Law and a Master's in Instructional Technology. She's a consultant and speaker, owner of ThriveinEDU LLC Consulting. Rachelle is an ISTE Certified Educator and serves as past president of the ISTE Teacher Education Network, serving on the leadership team of the Mobile Learning Network. At ISTE 19, she received the Making It Happen Award at a Presidential Gold Award for volunteer service to education. She is also a Buncee Ambassador, Nearpod Pioneer, and Microsoft Innovative Educator Expert. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. I am so glad to be here. I was so excited just thinking about it today. So thanks for the opportunity to chat.
Well, you have been very busy in all of this time. You're the author of 4 books, In Other Words, Quotes That Push Our Thinking, and then Unconventional Ways to Thrive in EDU, The Future is Now, Looking Back to Move Ahead, and your latest book with ISTE, Chart a New Course, A Guide to Teaching Essential Skills for Tomorrow's World. So you're also a blogger and for Getting Smart Defined Learning District Administrator, an NEO-LMS, and the STEM Informer with Newsweek. That is a busy life that you have, writing, never mind hosting your weekly show, ThriveEDU on Learning Revolution. Tell us a little bit about why you started writing and doing all of these different things in education.
Oh my gosh, it's so funny because you get into these kind of routines and you get involved in so many different activities and you feel like you've been doing them for so long. And then somebody asks you, what made you start or how did you get into that? And I really have to think like, yeah, why did I? Fortunately, somebody asked me a similar question not that long ago and it came to me and I laughed at the thought of it because it actually started, well, when I was probably 18, I was really big into reading books by John Grisham and Mary Higgins Clark and Danielle Steele. And there were just 3 authors that I really liked. And so I could not get through their books or get the newest one fast enough. But at that point, I thought, I wonder if I could write a book. So I tried to just start writing a book. I don't even remember what it was. I think it was probably a mix of all of their styles put into one because I thought, well, I could do this. And I wrote a decent amount, but forgot about it. Never thought about doing any writing besides for work or for classes I was taking. But then probably 7 years ago now, I thought about starting a blog, even though I didn't actually know what I would write about. And it just so happened, I started to use SurveyMonkey in my Spanish classes to do like a quick assessment or just to get some feedback from students. And I reached out to SurveyMonkey because I was doing presentations at conferences and I was taking students with me. And I thought it'd be kind of cool if I had something to kind of, you know, show as the symbol of SurveyMonkey. So people might say, hey, how are you using this in your class? And so they ended up sending me a box of flying monkeys, but they asked that I would write a blog about our experiences. And so that was my first real experience with writing anything. And I remember them saying at the time, somewhere around 600 to 800 words. And that just seemed so overwhelming to me. So that was actually the first thing that I consider that I wrote that was anything on this same kind of path that I've been on now. So it's kind of funny. And I still have a couple of those monkeys. So it's all good.
That's so cool. But then you like the extensive writing, but not just that, the responsiveness of your writing. How did that really evolve? Like, when did you decide to write the first book?
That's another funny one because I was, let's see here, 2020. So 2 years ago, somebody had mentioned to me, because I had been blogging for a while, that I should put all of my ideas into a book. And so they approached me about writing a book. And during the time, just in the conversations that we had, I was thinking about other possibilities for topics to put into that one book. So anyway, I went back to my notes because I've done a ton of reading just to see like what were some of my takeaways? What are some things that I could put into this book, like quotes or anything? And I actually realized that so much of what I had written were quotes. And so one night in August, I was thinking about the books, and I thought, I wonder if I could take a book or make a book that has quotes, and then what's my interpretation of them? How did it push my thinking? And so the next morning, I wrote up kind of a proposal about what if I write a book, in other words, quotes that push our thinking about education, and just gathered a bunch of quotes, and it ended up taking off the education part, because once I put that book together and I had other people contribute some stories and even some chapters in it, I realized it's not a book specific to just education. I mean, they are quotes that are relevant to everybody in life. And so it's just, it's interesting how that one just kind of came to be and ended up being the first one, but I was writing three at the same time. So it was interesting.
Wow. You know, it's so funny because today we're recording on Celebrate Monday, and the show airs on a Monday. And I think about the quotes that people put out there, are Monday motivation or any of the other hashtags for the week. But it's true. It's unpacking those quotes that make something so significant. And it's nice to know that, you know, at the same time as you're thinking about unpacking that, you're actually building these other books and finding other ways to help teachers. So in your role every day, how do you get to help teachers?
It's definitely evolved over the last couple of years, because as I've become more, I guess, involved in different learning networks, especially with ISTE and then the state affiliate, and doing a lot of work with my students really is what kind of transformed me in the work that I was doing, where I saw this need for helping teachers understand how to use different digital tools, or not even just about the technology, I mean, just different methods. So I was fortunate with my students because they were so willing to try some new ideas and then to go out and share what they were doing, how it was impacting their learning, and also share that with their teachers. And so I think it was definitely a collaborative process for that. But I also saw the benefits, I mean, just in observations, but in what the students were coming back and telling me. And so I really wanted to find a way to make it easier for other educators to get started with some of these things, because there are so many ideas out there that knowing where to begin, it's kind of like, okay, you have 50 tools, which one do I start with and how do you narrow it down? So I decided that if I can do a lot of the work, or I can share what the challenges were or how we've used it and make it easier for others to get started and then kind of take it in their own direction, then that's what I want to do. That's what makes me happy to do.
So there's like a collaboration with your students, and then you're collaborating with people to help them essentially and giving them their first steps, which can be so crucial in a, you know, an overly crowded space like education, where there are lots of answers and not necessarily answers that work for individuals. And so it's really important that you bridge that gap. But thinking about your collaborative process with your students brings me to this show. So that actually evolved with my students over many years to become the Personal Playlist Project, which became the Personal Playlist Podcast. So I asked you to bring three songs, one that's nostalgic, one that reflects your identity, and one that picks you up, lifts you up, inspires, or motivates. Tell me a little bit about the process for preparing for the show.
It was fun trying to think about the songs. And actually, when we were talking about that first book, in other words, at the end of that book, I talk about having a theme song. And so there are five songs that I have in there that I mean, they kind of are symbolic, or I don't know, they make me happy, or they're just, there's something to them that I ended up kind of making up my own song with those five. So music has always been really important to me. And just even, you know, if I hear a song on the radio or something, it usually brings up a memory of some point in my life. And so going through the process of trying to think, okay, which song is, I mean, one that's kind of a pick-me-up. There are a couple that come to mind. The hardest was thinking about the nostalgic songs, because I can remember different times being in the car, hearing something here on the Alexa, or just listening on my computer. And I couldn't think of those songs when I was trying to come up with my list. And it bothered me trying to think back, well, what was that one song? But it was fun to do, and to go back and think like, well, why did I like this song? Or what are the lyrics of the song, really, to closely look at some of the lyrics of, especially the nostalgic songs, the ones from when we were kids or whatever, to analyze the words in those songs now and think about them as an adult.
It's funny, actually, that you're talking about the challenge with the nostalgic song, because it forced me to look at the lyrics of a song that I never actually considered to be more than this really interesting video that happened when we were younger. So then to really think about this as a song about racial harmony and something that has such a positive message about everybody joining under this unified umbrella of nationhood. It was such a beautiful thing, and I had not thought about it that way. So why don't you take us to your nostalgic song and tell us a little bit about why you chose it?
Yeah, this is one that I struggle with, but it was kind of interesting because when I was thinking about the nostalgic song, the ones that kept coming up were Janet Jackson ones. And I mean, be all honest here, for a couple of the reasons was because I remember seeing the videos and spending time trying to learn the dance moves in the song. But there was something about the music and the words and Rhythm Nation. And like you said, too, I knew a lot of the words for it, but when I went back and looked back through it again, when I was getting the songs ready for this, I just thought, like, what a powerful song and the lyrics that are in it and just the music of it. And so it took me back. I mean, even in college years, just hearing this song, I don't know, it just brought back a lot of happy memories of times with family and with friends and learning to do things differently. But now looking back at the words that are in it, I just think it's so relevant, of course, to what we're experiencing today.
Mm-hmm. And it was interesting too, like you got me thinking about how a socially conscious theme and having a political viewpoint can also be synthesized with upbeat dance music that really gets you thinking about, you know, it was written in response to all these tragedies that had been in the media, but it's the beauty of music to be able to let you escape, but also to let you think deeper about things in a unique way. So I actually really appreciate that you brought this back into my mind, but thinking about that video and the dancers in their unisex military attire and thinking about all the different ways that a music video adds dimension to a message. It's such an interesting thing. When you're thinking about university or college, thinking about this song, did you guys work together to practice these dances? Was that like your group?
No, that was kind of just my own thing. I just, it was so unique to me. I really enjoyed dancing and was something, I took dancing as a child, but then it didn't last very long because apparently it conflicted with some TV shows that I wanted to watch at the time. So then I picked up some new hobbies like playing musical instruments. And I guess I was a little bit challenging in that sense as a kid, but I was a majorette in college at Penn State and dance was a big part of it. And so I just really, and we would go out as teenagers, you know, to local places that had the under 21 dancing. And that was our Sunday night kind of thing to get together and to dance and to feel comfortable hanging out with different people from different schools. And so it really was a way to kind of extend our circle. And just thinking back even now to all the different people that I met that came in from, you know, 25, 30 miles away, parents would drop them off and we just connected in that space and had fun dancing and the music. So all of that kind of came back. But I don't know, there was something about just wanting to learn that dance and other dances. And so it was kind of a solo act at that point.
Okay, let's play it. Rhythm Nation by Janet Jackson.
Three, two, one.
It's amazing how songs are in time and also timeless.
I know. Yeah, listening to it, I was just, I don't know, it just kind of takes you back. And then you think about the words of it, and some of them definitely stick out and resonate with me. Even still, after I forget what year this song actually came out. Interesting.
It is. It's interesting. And there are songs that can work in so many different ways. And when you're going back, it's amazing how it can also take you to this exact time right now. But an identity song is timeless in its own way, because at any point your songs can change. And that's what's so funny about curating your P3 is tomorrow you might have chosen three completely different songs. But right now, in where you're at, this next song spoke to you about who you are and what you want to say about yourself at this exact moment. So why this song?
Yeah, it is one of the songs that I put, actually two of these three are ones that I put into that book, in other words, but there's just something about this song. A lot of times people ask on Twitter, on Facebook, what's a song that lifts you up, or what's a song that's kind of like your theme song or something? And this one always comes to mind because I think about, I mean, the lyrics of it, but also just in our own lives about, you know, we're not like, the story isn't over. Like, there's always something to do. We can keep growing and keep learning. And I mean, there's opportunities everywhere. I could throw a lot of those kind of ideas out there, but just going through the different lyrics in it, plus the music of it, it definitely, I don't know, it's a good song that I think that helps me to reflect. It definitely brings a smile to my face when I hear it. And even I notice that whenever I play music for my students, when they come into my classroom, I have a playlist. And years ago, I used to always just play Zumba music because I would have these CDs because I got certified as a Zumba instructor. And it's great as a language teacher because you get the DVDs. And I was actually having my students go with there's a teacher in my high school who is a music and dance teacher. And so he would actually take some of my students and teach them some of these different dances. So it was working out really well to get my students up and moving. But I shifted from that and just made kind of a playlist, songs that I chose, some very nostalgic songs, some that made them roll their eyes. What is this song? And then I asked them for their ideas too. But I noticed that whenever this one would come up throughout the year, I mean, my students, you could just see in their faces when they would come in, and even the students in the hall passing by kind of looking and just see them kind of bounce around a little bit. There's just something about it that kind of lightens the mood a little bit. But if you take time to think about the lyrics of it, it really does open you up to, I don't know, pushing through a challenge you might be having too, because you're just like, just go for it.
Okay, well, we'll go for it. Let's play Unwritten by Natasha Bedingfield. Your next book begin?
I don't know. I need to start it, actually.
Oh, like legitimately? It's like trying to be esoteric about it, but you're right. You're in the middle of writing another one.
But I do like how you said that there, but it's true. It's like the best is yet unwritten, right? We have opportunities to try something, do something different. And, never know what we're capable of until we give it a go, and might not go well, but there's still tremendous power of learning that happens in that, even if we're not as successful the first time or however many times it takes, there's tons of possibilities out there.
It's actually funny that you said that. I was just interviewing one of our mentors and mentee, and the mentee was saying that, you know, she became a teacher to have a definite sense of how to do things. And it was really hard for her to deal with that idea of the unwritten, that, you know, she thought this is systematically how you do something. And then if it doesn't work, it must be her fault. And seeing her get support through that thinking and really open herself up to the possibility of life being unwritten and education really being unwritten, and that you have so much agency and so much learning potential always, and how many things that you're open to allow you to open up to new ideas and new people and new growth. It's an incredible thing about education, but it's also intimidating unless you wrap your head around it, like that there is no real end. There's always room for something more, but I find it extremely exciting.
Yeah, me too. And one of my favorite lines of it is about the, I think sometimes my tries are outside the lines. And I think that is so me. I'm not always just right straight in line. I mean, I'm always trying to go outside different kind of thinking, and may not necessarily be the way that somebody else intended or that I even intended, but you know, you just try.
Yeah. And I think that that leads us really nicely to your pick me up song. And you said that that song was not in the book. So you could have chosen lots of songs, and clearly, like with Zumba, there's a lot of options in terms of pick me up. So why this song, and what does it say about you?
Yeah, there's something again about the music of this and just the lyrics and the pace of it that just kind of gets your adrenaline going a little bit. Another song that I would play when my students would come in too, but I don't know, whenever I feel kind of like I'm hitting up against a wall or overwhelmed, and there's definitely been times like that over the past couple of months, as we all know, right? We're experiencing so much, but just even in general, and trying to kind of push through a lot of those. So I keep it in the back of my mind that, I mean, as a person, as a teacher, whatever my role is, I have to do whatever it takes and just keep going. And I think for myself, I don't really like to take a break too often, because I feel like if I do, that's when I'm going to miss an opportunity that's going to help somebody else. And I've always kind of been the type of person where I can't just focus on one thing. I need to be doing multiple things, because I don't know, ever since going to law school, I think that's just kind of how I transformed into making everything fit between teaching full time and going to school at night and all of that. So I built up this kind of, I don't know, crazy kind of schedule for myself, and just, I don't want to quit. So for me, it's kind of like, I'll do whatever it takes to get through whatever it is. Even when sometimes I convince myself there's no way that I'm going to be able to do this, I give myself a pause and just keep on going.
And maybe you play this song. So here it is.
I do.
Imagine Dragons, Whatever It Takes.
Falling too fast to prepare for this. Tripping in the world could be dangerous. Everybody circling as vultures. Negative, nepotist. Everybody waiting for the fall of man. Everybody praying for the end of times. Everybody hoping they could be the one. I was born to run, I was born for this. Whip, whip, run me like a racehorse. Pull me like a ripcord. Break me down and build me up. I wanna be the slip, slip. Word upon your lip, lip. Rather that you rip, rip. Break me down and build me up. Whatever it takes. Hanging on to the visual, I wanna be invisible. Looking at my years like I'm out of dumb. Everybody needs to be a part of them. Never be enough from the prodigal son. I was born to run, I was born for this. Whip, whip, run me like a racehorse. Pull me like a ripcord. Break me down and build me up. I wanna be the slip, slip. Word upon your lip, lip.
are a build outside the blocks kind of person, but what gets that adrenaline in your veins?
I don't know, just chances to try something different. When I learn something and I know that I can use it to help somebody else, when I accomplish something that I know that I've basically talked myself out of thinking that I could do, making everything kind of fit into my schedule and still having some time for self-care, which is something that I've really been trying to work on. I don't know. I mean, it's just like a combination of things that, I don't know. It just makes me really happy to do work that I'm passionate about and also to help other educators. I mean, just people, it's something that I've really enjoyed doing over the last couple of years is using what I know, sharing my own challenges and experiences, and really being vulnerable and open about the changes that I've made and how it has, I mean, obviously benefited me, but the difference that it has made in me besides personally, but professionally, and especially when it comes to relationships with my students and just my connections as an educator with other educators in the world.
Amazing. So you host the weekly show ThriveinEDU on Learning Revolution. It's on Wednesdays and invites guests to discuss topics related to education and emerging technology. Where can people find your podcast? Where can people find your blog? How can people find you and continue to thrive on the adrenaline that you share and all the amazing work that you do?
I am pretty consistent when it comes to a lot of those things because I use, for Twitter, it's RDENE915, and pretty much my blog, my email, my Instagram, my podcast are all focused on that same RDENE915, or also for my show, like the podcast is called ThriveinEDU, the same as my show, and a Facebook community that I started as well for ThriveinEDU too. So I try to be kind of consistent in that regard.
Okay, well, people, if you're listening, follow Rachelle, Twitter, Instagram, follow her work, read her books, and continue to be inspired by somebody who's inspired by you. How do you feel sharing your playlist today?
It's good. It's fun to do. And I just think it gives different perspectives too, just to hear the different songs that are out there and why people choose them. And then to kind of look at the words. And sometimes, I mean, I really do. Music for me is definitely a way to kind of escape and self-care where I can just take some time. And it's always been that. Always been that way. I love listening to music, playing music, especially live music. And so there's just so much power in it. And it's a great thing to use in our classrooms too. There's so many ways to use it. So,
for sure. Again, I want to thank you so much for your time. Is there anything you want to add before I play you out?
No, I think that's it. Thank you so much for having me on and having the discussion. This was definitely fun to do and think about the songs and to talk with you today.
It was nice to talk to you too. Have a wonderful day.
You as well.
Thank you for joining us on the P3, the Personal Playlist Podcast. I'm Noah Daniel. This is Voice Ed Radio, and I hope you have a fantastic day.